Before I started making Video Tech Explained, I had, and still have, another YouTube channel where I would occasionally post a very different kind of video. See, for many years now, I've had a passion for examining the opening title sequences of various movies and TV shows, and trying my best to recreate them from scratch. And I would frequently recreate the same title sequences over and over again, refining my skills each time. Now, why do I like to do this? Honestly, I don't know. But anyway, one of my favorite title sequences to remake has always been the opening credits of Star Trek: The Next Generation. It's both iconic and, well, not that complicated, at least on the surface. But one day I happened to be scrolling through a wiki article about the studio model of the Enterprise that was used during said opening title sequence, as one does. And while I was there, I found a section describing a fascinating technique that was used to create a specific part of the title sequence. And that part is right here. As the Enterprise jumps into warp speed, its warp nacelles flash brilliantly, and the ship stretches forward like a rubber band, before rocketing off into space and disappearing with another flash of light. This effect may seem simple at first glance, but when you really stop and think about it, it raises a very interesting question. How did they make the ship stretch like that? I mean, nowadays, when models are animated inside a computer, it's extremely simple to make one of them stretch on demand. You just keyframe the scaling and position along the desired axis, and that's all there is to it. But this title sequence wasn't done with CGI. As I mentioned before, the Enterprise, as seen in The Next Generation, is a physical studio model. Well, it's actually three different studio models at different scales, but whatever. Point is, how do you make a 6-foot fiberglass and aluminum model stretch like a rubber band? To answer that question, we need to go all the way back to the late 1950s. This video is sponsored by Privado VPN. Privado VPN creates a secure, encrypted tunnel for your internet traffic to protect it from snooping by your internet service provider or anyone else on your local network. Additionally, Privado VPN allows you to browse the internet as though you're in one of 60 different countries. And if you're privacy-minded like me, you can rest assured that Privado VPN has a strict no-logs policy. Visit the link down below to get up to 82% off for a limited time with their special Valentine's Day deal. Thanks again to Privado VPN for sponsoring this video. Now, on with the show. Have you ever seen those photos of city streets at night where the headlights of the passing cars are transformed into long streaks of light like this? Well, this effect is achieved using a long exposure. Every camera has a shutter which controls how long the sensor or film negative will collect light in order to create an image. Ordinarily, the shutter opens and closes in just a fraction of a second. But by deliberately leaving it open for much longer, some interesting effects can be created. If the shutter is left open for seconds or even minutes, then any motion blur in the frame will be greatly exaggerated. In the previous example, we can see this in action. The shutter is open for long enough that the positions of the passing cars change significantly from the beginning of the shot to the end. When the shutter opens, the lights from the headlights are hitting one part of the sensor, and when it closes, they're hitting another. So the camera will see the headlights in many different positions simultaneously, resulting in a continuous blur of light across the frame. But a long exposure alone isn't enough to create the warp drive effect used in The Next Generation. It would work if the goal was to make the ship blur across the frame like this, but that's not what Gene Roddenberry wanted. He wanted the ship to stretch like a rubber band. In order to achieve that, a more advanced technique would be required. Thankfully, an evolution of the long exposure had already been invented in 1958 by animator John Whitney for the opening credits of Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo. By taking individual points of light and spinning them around while the camera took a long exposure photograph, he created some very interesting and colorful shapes that could even move over time. By taking a series of these long exposure images and slightly varying the color, position, and motion of the different light sources, the resulting pattern could be animated smoothly. Whitney called this technique a slit scan. Over the next few decades, the slit scan technique would be adapted and used for a lot more than just making some pretty patterns. But before we talk about how it was used in the next generation, let's look at another historical example. Slit scanning would be used most famously in Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey. During the production of the film, Kubrick learned of Whitney's slit scan technique and decided to adapt it in order to create the Stargate sequence at the end of the film. If you've ever seen 2001, you'll know what I'm talking about. After the astronaut Dave Bowman makes contact with the monolith near Jupiter, he travels through a gateway, which is visualized using a psychedelic pattern of moving shapes and colors. So, how was the slit scan effect used to create this sequence? Well, let's go through the process step by step, and I'll show you how you can make your very own Stargate. First, obtain a piece of glass about 14 feet wide and layer on some colorful patterned gels in order to create a psychedelic pattern of shapes and colors. Next, light this glass from behind and then use a thick black material to block out all but a tiny sliver of the pattern. This slit should be tall enough to span the entire height of the frame, but as thin as possible. After that, it's time to set up the camera. It should be positioned on a 12-foot long track, driven by a motor so that the camera will move towards the pattern at a precisely controlled rate. The end of this track should be positioned very close to the lit pattern, so that the camera almost touches it. Also make sure that the slit is offset slightly, so that when the camera reaches its ending position, the slit will be just outside the frame. To test out the configuration, set up the camera so that its shutter is open while it moves smoothly along its track. Looking at the result, we can see that the pattern is being stretched across the frame in a very interesting way. When the exposure begins, the slit is in the middle of the frame and far away, and when the exposure ends, it's just outside the frame and much closer. So the pattern that shines through the slit blurs continuously across the sensor or negative. But this isn't really what we're looking for. Because the pattern is the same at the beginning of the frame as at the end, there's no variation in the color or pattern from one end of the frame to the other. It just looks like a blur. To fix this, we need the pattern to change during the exposure. So the glass containing the pattern should be rigged up to move about 10 inches as the camera travels along its track. Rendering this out, we finally see the slit scan that we're looking for. The base pattern is stretched across the frame in a really cool and non-linear way, thanks to the parallax introduced by the camera's movement. The closer the camera gets to the slit, the faster it moves across the frame, so the pattern becomes increasingly stretched and distorted the closer it gets to the edge. Cool! Now all we need to do is capture the other half of the Stargate using a slightly different pattern, merge the two together with a bit of compositing, and bam! A Stargate worthy of Kubrick himself. Now, you may be wondering at this point how I created that shot without building a giant motion-controlled camera rig in a studio somewhere. Well, this is really cool. It's actually possible to recreate this old-school optical technique within modern 3D graphics software and achieve the same results as you could with a physical camera and light source. See, some rendering algorithms utilize ray tracing to essentially simulate the way that light works in the real world. So this way, all we have to do to create a long exposure slit scan is to set up the scene the same way it would be set up in real life, and configure our settings appropriately, and everything just kinda works. So to create the slit scan effect inside of Blender, just set up the scene the way I described it earlier, and keyframe the motion of the camera and pattern so that they're at their starting positions on frame 0, and their ending positions on frame 1. Then make sure the Cycles renderer is selected, and go down into the Motion Blur settings. By default, Blender will sample across half the duration of a frame to create a 180-degree shutter, and then that time period will be centered around the frame itself. But that's not what we want. We want to sample the entire duration of time between frame 0 and frame 1. So to achieve that, turn the shutter up to 1.0, and change the position to end on frame. Then set the playhead to frame 1 and render the image. Voila!
If you set up this scene correctly, everything should just work. Now, to animate this effect, we need to render the shot multiple times, with the pattern slightly offset each time. But since the effect only works when rendering on frame 1, we can't just keyframe the pattern as we normally would. Instead, I wrote some simple code that will repeatedly adjust the delta transform of the pattern by a fixed amount, and then render a new frame. Running this script results in a smoothly animated effect with minimal manual input. Just adjust the speed parameter until it looks right. I'll have this code linked in the description down below if you'd like to use it. Okay, so we've seen how the slit scan effect can be used to make a two-dimensional image stretch across the frame in a really cool and organic way. But the technique I just described still won't work to create this warp drive effect, because it can only stretch an image two-dimensionally. For example, in this warp drive shot here, the Enterprise's axis of movement is perfectly horizontal in the frame. So a conventional slit scan can be used to stretch the image of the ship relative to the camera's perspective. A slit can be placed directly in front of the camera lens and moved during the exposure in order to scan from left to right. Then the ship can be moved at a slightly different speed so that each little slice of the ship lingers in the visible part of the frame for just a bit longer than it normally would. By adjusting the speed of the ship during the exposure, the stretch factor can be adjusted and animated. But in the other three warp drive shots used throughout the next generation, the Enterprise's axis of movement is more complex relative to the perspective of the camera. If a conventional slit scan were used to make the ship stretch, then the results would be, well, less than convincing. It's sort of like if you took a still image of the Enterprise and tried to use a perspective warp effect in Photoshop in order to create the stretch. It's just not gonna work. But then, visual effects coordinator Rob Legato had an idea. Instead of moving the slit in front of the camera, what if they moved the slit in front of their light sources? Instead of lighting the ship normally, it would be lit by a thin slit of light that would scan from the back of the ship to the front. While the slit scanned across the ship, the camera would move away while its shutter was open. The result of this is that the rear parts of the ship would be exposed when the camera is close to the model, and the front parts of the ship would be exposed when the camera was farther away. So the ship will appear to stretch forward three-dimensionally. So, of course, once I wrapped my head around this, I knew what had to be done. I was going to recreate this effect myself, and while I was at it, I might as well recreate the rest of the title sequence as well. I mean, why not? Once again, I set up a scene in Blender which recreated the real-life technique as closely as possible. The Enterprise was lit by four area lights of varying intensities, which were masked off by some planes with slits cut into them. I keyframed the mask objects that the light would scan from the back of the ship to the front in a single frame, and then I made sure that the camera would also move backwards during the same time. Rendering it out, I got a pretty good result. But even with the basic effect figured out, there were still a few challenges to overcome. For one thing, it was very difficult to figure out exactly how the camera should move during the exposure. Usually, when recreating a shot like this, I'll use an overlay in order to match up the camera's position and orientation at key moments. But since the reference footage features the distorted version of the ship, it was a lot more difficult to line up the length and direction of the stretch. I was able to find this behind-the-scenes footage showing the filming of one of these shots, but because everything is blacked out, it's impossible to tell how the camera is moving. There was also the problem of animating the stretch over time. The effect is only 20 frames long, so at first I tried to match up each individual frame with the reference footage, but the result was far too jittery since I was basically just eyeballing the transformation on each frame. Eventually, I decided to choose a small number of keyframes to match up and then let Blender automatically interpolate between those positions. I lined up the starting frame, the frame where the stretch is at its maximum, and the ending frame. Now, to interpolate between these keyframes and render out the sequence, I ended up resorting to this very tedious and manual process involving duplicating cameras and copy-pasting keyframes between them. In hindsight, I probably should have just written some code to automate this, but since the shot was only 20 frames long, I figured it wasn't too much of a hassle. Anyway, after a few attempts, I eventually got the animation looking good. There are a few additional limitations with this process to keep in mind, however. For one thing, this process doesn't allow for any light sources to be present aside from the slit light. If I leave the ship's interior and exterior light sources on, then they'll blur across the rendered frame and break the effect. So all of the Enterprise's self-illuminating elements had to be turned off, which creates a continuity issue with the preceding shot of the Enterprise flying past the camera. Also, on a few frames, sections of the ship that are scanned later actually overlap with sections scanned earlier. So part of the ship appears to turn semi-transparent and allow another part of the ship to bleed through. So how did ILM solve all these problems back in 1987? Simple, they didn't. Both of these issues are totally visible on the original title sequence. As soon as the slit scan effect begins, all of the Enterprise's lights blink off. And there are a few frames on which the Enterprise appears to go partially transparent. Have you ever noticed this? I mean, I didn't until I started researching this video. Now, the issue with the ship lights blinking off was fixed in the remastered version by manually adding the light sources back in with digital tools, but there's no way to do it in camera. Additionally, ILM found it impractical to try and film the slit scan effect using the main 6-foot studio model of the Enterprise. The 6-foot model was used for the main flyby, but it was too big and cumbersome to be used with the slit scan technique. So they used the smaller 2-foot model to film the warp effect and covered up the transition by making the Enterprise's warp engines flash and blow out the frame for a moment. Yeah, that's why the warp engines flash. It's to cover up the slight mismatch between the 6-foot model filmed with conventional lighting and the 2-foot model filmed with slit scan. ILM ultimately filmed 3 different versions of the warp drive effect, which were recycled throughout the show's run. Later shows like Deep Space Nine and Voyager also featured ships that stretched forward as they jumped into warp speed. But by the time these shows were in production, CGI had gotten much better, so the warp drive effect could be created by simply adjusting the scaling of a virtual model inside the computer. But even though the warp drive effect is much easier to do inside of a computer, I find it absolutely fascinating how visual effects artists developed complex techniques to bend space and time using nothing but light and a bit of film. So if you'd like to check out my full recreation of the Next Generation title sequence, including the slit scan effect, I'll have it linked in the description down below. But anyways, I hope you all enjoyed this video. My name is Cayman Crocker, signing off.